So today we will look at transistor parameter extractions, namely we will look at threshold voltage extraction, mobility extraction, which is a very important parameter when you are talking of transport in a FET. So in addition to that, we will also look at what is called effective channel length extraction, and finally again the interface trap density extraction using a transistor structure, not using a capacitance voltage technique but using a current measurement technique, okay. So then let us get started with the threshold voltage extraction. You know, the if you recall, the drain current of a field effect transistor is essentially given by this equation. So, you know, depending on again whether you are in a linear region or saturation region, these currents could be approximated. For example, when you are in linear region, we say that the transistor is in linear region, you know, when VDS is very, very small compared to VGS, then it is linear region of operation, okay. In other words, in linear region, if you were to look at IDS versus VDS characteristics, you know, the current will initially increase in the linear region, and hence that is for the small VDS values, and hence the name linear region, and eventually the current will saturate, okay. And that is when we say we have reached the saturation region. We reach a saturation region when VDS makes a transition to this value VGS minus VT, okay. At some value of VDS, VDS becomes equal to the gate voltage that is applied on the transistor minus the threshold voltage. At that point, you know, the transistor current starts saturating, and the saturation current value is essentially obtained by substituting VDS is equal to VGS minus VT in this equation, okay. And hence, you know, you get ID sat or saturation current value as mu n C aux W by L, which is essentially a dimensional parameter and the transport parameter, how good is the mobility for the transistor, right. And now you put VDS is equal to VGS minus VT, and you have VDS square by 2 here, VGS minus VT square by 2, and hence you essentially get VGS minus VT square divided by 2, okay. That is your you know, current in the saturation region, okay. And let me rewrite that here. ID sat is mu n C aux W by L VGS minus VT whole square divided by 2, okay. Now notice that, you know, both in the linear region, of course, in the linear region one can again make an approximation. You can ignore this VDS square term because VDS is so small. So in the linear region, you can also approximate your drain current as what is called IDS linear, that can be approximated as, you know, just this first term, okay, mu n C aux W by L VG minus VT times VDS, okay, right. So let me write it here. IDS linear is mu n C aux W by L VGS minus VT times VDS. I am ignoring the quadratic part of VDS because VDS is very, very small, okay. And remember, the C aux here is per unit area capacitance, it is not the total capacitance in this equation, okay. That is the oxide capacitance per unit area. Now notice that whether you look at the linear region current or the saturation region current, there is an important parameter which is the threshold voltage here. So, you know, obviously it also indicates that if we can do a IV characterization either in linear region or in saturation region, from that we should be able to extract the threshold voltage, okay. So let us see how one can do that, okay. Now let us look at the VT extraction from linear IDS versus VGS characterization. So in this measurement technique, what you do is that you put VDS as very small voltage, let's say of the order of 50 millivolt, very small value on the drain voltage. Source is of course grounded, and you ramp VG from 0 to some large value, 5 volt. Now, what is that value depends on what is the dimension of the transistor. Of course, if the dimension of the transistor is in 20-30 nanometer with 1 nanometer gate oxide, you obviously do not go to 5 volt, because you know that operating voltage of the transistor itself is going to be 1 volt or 1.5 volt. Okay. You go from 0 volt to, in general, what I call VDD, where VDD is the operating voltage of the transistor. The threshold voltage is somewhere in between. It is obviously more than 0 for an n-channel transistor, of course less than the operating voltage, and we need to determine what is the threshold voltage value. So when you do this measurement, what you will end up getting is a characteristics which looks like this typically. Okay. This is 0 here, almost 0. We know that sub threshold current is never 0 in a transistor. Even when VG is equal to 0, the transistor current is not 0. We have all studied that. Now I am ramping VG from 0 to some VDD value here. This is the maximum value that the transistor can sustain, and accordingly you have different values of the current. When I plot this in a linear scale, the current here looks very small. Okay. Now what we also note here is that these equations that we are writing for the transistor are really valid only when the transistor is turned on, not when the transistor is off, right. Only when the transistor is on we write these current voltage equation. That is, when I approach the gate voltage value, which is very close to VT, obviously you see start seeing departure from these equations. Right, whether it is a linear current equation or a saturation current equation, when VT approaches comes very close to VGS, right, you start having departure. Okay. But if you look at the linear region current, what this indicates is that current is expected to be a linear function of VGS when VGS is larger than threshold voltage value. So then what one could do is that one could look at this IDS versus VGS value and try to extrapolate this linear region behavior. This looks almost like a straight line, and say that, okay, if I extrapolate it, it is as if that equation were to be true, at this value of VGS the current would go to 0, you see, and hence I would say that when I extrapolate it, I get a value here, and that I call as threshold voltage. Okay. So far so good, but you see in this equation, even though you have this relationship, I said that IDS is linear function of VGS. I am making an assumption, you see here, of course VDS is constant, but I am making an assumption that WL are constant, which is obviously true, Cox is constant, which is obviously true, but more importantly I am making an assumption mobility is constant. When I am ramping this gate voltage, mobility is not changing, right. But in practice that is no longer the case. When you actually ramp the gate voltage, as you start increasing the gate voltage to larger and larger value, your mobility starts degrading. We have discussed this in one of the earlier classes, because mobility depends on large number of parameters, scattering due to interface and so on and so forth, impurity scattering for example, and it also depends on the vertical electric field. If the vertical electric field, which is set up by applying a gate voltage, becomes larger and larger, it will impede the free movement of electrons in the lateral direction, right. So mobility will not be constant. So in other words, what you will invariably see when you do this kind of an IV measurement is that you won't really get a very nice straight line like this, but instead your IV measurement will look something like this. Okay, of course here it's very small current, and here you start having like this. Okay, now the question is, okay, I need to do the extrapolation, correct, to get the threshold voltage for when VG is greater than VT, but where do you want to do extrapolation? If I do a tangent here, that will give a different intercept. If I put a tangent here, that could give you a different intercept and so on and so forth, right. So, now there is this confusion in estimation of threshold voltage, okay. So, a workaround for this is what we define as something called peak GM VT extraction. What it means is the following. Now, I have got a measurement of IDS versus VGS. Now, based on this IDS versus VGS, you also generate dIDS by dVGS versus VGS curve. What is dIDS over dVGS? It is called a transconductance of a transistor. Okay? You vary the input voltage and you look at the variation in the output current, and the variation of the output current to the variation of the input voltage has a unit of conductance, but it is defined on two different ports, output port and input port, and hence it is a transconductance. Okay? So, once I have IDS versus VGS, I can very easily create dIDS versus dVGS plot, and that will look something like this typically. If you actually do this in the lab, your transconductance, this is what we call GM or transconductance. And what this procedure tells us is that you do a IDVG measurement, and from the IDVG measurement you also create this transconductance curve, and you locate the point where transconductance goes to a peak and go to that point on this axis, on this curve rather, IDS VGS curve, and at this point you put a tangent, I mean you put an extrapolation here. Okay? And if you have this extrapolation done, and that will intersect this VGS axis, and this is what I call threshold voltage. In other words, what this peak GM VT extraction procedure is telling you is to locate a point on IDS VGS curve to put a, you know, tangent there and sort of do a extrapolation to get a, you know, threshold voltage value, right. So, this is what is, you know, very popularly used in all these, you know, when you do a circuit simulation, for example, there is a VTH 0 parameter in circuit simulation, and that VTH 0 parameter is typically obtained using so called the peak GM VT extraction. Okay. So, this is how we essentially define the threshold voltage or compute the threshold voltage from the curves here. Now, once you have the threshold voltage, how do you get mobility? Mobility can be obtained from this dIDS over dVGS, right. I have already created dIDS over dVGS, okay. And if you go back to this equation, what is your dIDS over dVGS? You differentiate this. So, it is essentially this factor, correct, times this factor. I am differentiating with respect to dVGS. Okay. So, you know, this goes to unity, and this is essentially a multiplication factor for this VGS minus VTH. Okay. So, as a result of that, my GM that I am computing here, the GM is essentially mu n C aux W by L times VDS. You know what is the VDS because you are applying that drain voltage for your measurement. Okay. And you know what is your W because you have, you know, printed the transistor, and you know what is your L, and you also know what is your oxide thickness. You know, you can extract oxide thickness using CV measurement as I have already told you, and you also found out what is GM, and from this you can extract mobility. Okay. And you know, you will be able to precisely estimate the mobility of the transistor, and the fact that the GM is going down here, and that is essentially a reflection of the fact that mobility is actually degrading as I am increasing the gate voltage to larger and larger value. Okay. Now, this is one way of doing a VT extraction, okay. And the peak GM extrapolation technique that I mentioned. And there is another way of defining VT, what is called constant current definition of VT. What we mean by this is that you know, rather than doing all this extrapolation, we will just say that look, when my transistor gives a current of let us say 100 nanoampere, I call that as a threshold voltage point, and that current can be chosen, you know, the way based on the experience. Okay. You can fix a current. If you were to fix a current, all you need to do is that look at that current value and you know go to the appropriate voltage value, and hence you know what is the threshold voltage value. But you see, the current is also a function of W and L of the transistor, right. So, what you do is the current that you choose, you normalize that current by W by L ratio. In other words, if your W by L of the transistor is more, you also have to multiply that current with that W by L factor, right. Only then you will be able to get the appropriate threshold voltage value using this constant current definition. In other words, what you are saying is that you are saying that I define VDS as that value, okay, let me just, okay. So, let us say I am going to define my constant current as IDS is 100 nanoampere times W by L. What it means is that if I choose a transistor of 1 micron W and 1 micron length, I look at a 100 nanoampere current. But instead, if I choose a transistor of 2 micron length, okay, and you know 1 micron width, okay, I would essentially be looking at a 200 nanoampere current, because W by L is large, you will get larger current, and that will anyway happen, right. So, you need to have this factor taken into account. Okay. So, then what you do is essentially you look at your IDS versus VGS plot and you say you have chosen this current, you know what is the W by L, and you get the right current value, and you say that okay, look, for this transistor, whenever I have a value of this current, whatever that current I have defined, I say that this is my threshold voltage. Okay, this is another very simple way of defining a threshold voltage, right, wherein you do not have to worry about extrapolation and all that. So, in literature sometimes you will see threshold voltage defined by multiple ways, either using a constant current definition or using peak GMVT definition. Peak GMVT definition is the most commonly used practice of extraction of threshold voltage. There is another way of doing this threshold voltage extraction, and that is, if you recall, when we do IDS versus VGS measurement, and if we plot that IDS versus VGS with a log scale for current, remember this current looks, you know, this is linear, because below threshold current will be exponential function of gate voltage, and once you reach threshold the current will be maybe linear or quadratic function. If the measurement is being done in a linear region, it will be a linear function of VGS. If the measurement is being done with the saturation condition, it is a quadratic function. Certainly this quadratic variation is much, you know, gentler variation compared to the steep variation, which is an exponential variation. So, what one could say is that look, there is a transition from sub threshold to linear or sub threshold to quadratic. I pick that transition point and call that as a threshold voltage, right. So, then one can define, you know, then again the question is where will you put that point, right. So, what one could do is that maybe one could sort of, you know, extrapolate this and sort of extrapolate this and say that look, this is the point of transition. Below this point it looks like a sub threshold region, and above this point it looks like a above threshold region. So, this transition point is my threshold voltage of the transistor. Okay. So, this is another way of defining a threshold voltage. So, there are multiple ways one can use and define a threshold voltage and accordingly extract the value of the threshold voltage. Okay. As I said, this can be done in linear region or as well as in saturation region, and similarly this constant current thing can also be done in linear region or in saturation region. Okay. And similarly, this extrapolation can also be done in linear region or in saturation region, except that when you do this extrapolation in saturation region, because the saturation current is quadratic with respect to VGS minus VT, which we have written here, right. So, you do not plot IDS versus VGS, you plot root IDS versus VGS. That is the only difference, because root IDS will be a linear function of VGS because of this quadratic dependence. So, that is the only difference as far as extrapolation technique is concerned for saturation region, right. So, the saturation extrapolation, you look at root IDS versus VGS and you know extrapolate from that curve, and then as a result of that you get your threshold voltage, okay. And in order to get mobility, this is the technique, right. You essentially obtain DID over DVGS, and from that you can extract transconductance, and from transconductance you get the mobility, okay, right. And even to get, you know, when we did that, we said that, you know, I know C aux because I have computed that T aux from capacitance voltage measurement, right. You need not do that on a MOS capacitor, you can do that CV measurement on a transistor itself. And once you do the CV measurement on transistor, you can get the C aux, and you can do the use that C aux in this computation, and you can get the mobility, okay, fine. So, the next important thing that we need to find out is what is called L effective or effective channel length. Sometimes also defined as electrical channel length. Okay. Now, first of all, let us understand, you know, why is it different from physical channel length. So, now if you look at the transistor, remember that you know I have this gate, and you know this is what we call gate length, which is LG. LG is different from L effective, you see. And then what do? You do the ion implantation, and there is a diffusion, and eventually your junctions will be formed. Okay, N plus and N plus, correct. And what, when we say L effective, what we are saying is the following. I have made this transistor with certain printed gate length, which you can always measure if you put this transistor under a electron microscope, if it is a nanometric transistor, right. And you can actually see how wide is the gate, okay, physically you can look at it. And then you have the junctions. But eventually when you are doing the transistor action by applying the gate voltage, you are only varying the conductivity in this region, you see. So, this is your effective transistor length, which is being modulated. Only the conductivity of this region is being modulated. You cannot modulate the conductivity of this region, not this region, because it is so heavily doped. This is a P region. And this P region conductivity is being modulated by applying an appropriate voltage on the gate terminal. So, the question is, how will you be able to measure this? In other words, electrically the transistor looks as if it has this gate length, not this gate length, okay, because I am not able to modulate this region anyway, okay. So, you know, this can be computed only if you know what is this lateral diffusion. And you know, fortunately for us, there is a very easy technique to compute that lateral diffusion just by doing an electrical measurement, okay. I do not have to do, you cannot do it by the way using a optical or electron microscopy, because you know if you are doing electron microscopy as is, right, this is also silicon, this is also silicon, there are, you know, the same material, you know, how will you distinguish the two materials, right, unless you do some you know very rigorous post processing and try to see, you know, how much is the diffusion which is taking place laterally. It is a very difficult thing. So, what we do here is that in order to estimate this, we do the electrical measurement, okay, for L effective extraction. First of all, we choose transistors with same W, but different transistors, multiple transistors, that is not one transistor, different L values. When I say L here, this L is what is there on my mask, which I used in photolithography process, you know, based on that mask, I have printed some gate, but I do not know what is L effective. Okay. But what I will do is that I will choose this different length transistors, and we when we write this transistor equation as IDS is equal to mu n Cox by W by L, you see in reality it is actually L effective. What is the channel length, electrical channel length of the transistor which is being modulated, and that will essentially determine what is the current, and it is this L effective that we would like to compute. Okay. And as I said, if you are in linear region, VGS minus VT times VDS, right, this is a linear region current. Okay. So, what I do is that if I, before we go to the measurement, let us just do some algebraic adjustments here. Let me compute this VDS over IDS, which we also call as R channel, channel resistance. What is it? It is essentially given by L effective, but from this equation, you know, VDS divided by IDS is L effective divided by mu n Cox W VG minus VT, correct. Now, we want to compute this L effective. And what is this L effective, by the way? L effective is L minus what we call 2 delta L. What is this delta L? This is delta L. And there is a lateral diffusion from source side and the drain side. These two lateral diffusions are exactly identical. They would not be any different because it is all symmetric device anyway. Okay. Fortunately for us, you see, this delta L does not depend on what is the actual printed length. In other words, if I have an another transistor here, okay, which has not this LG value, but maybe a different LG value, even in this case, this delta L that I have here will be same as this delta L, because why is this delta L coming? You have an implantation and there is a lateral diffusion, right. Implantation is always at the edge of the gate, you see, and hence the lateral diffusion, whether it is a 1 micron length channel or 10 micron length channel, is always the same, and that is what is going to help us in getting the L effective value, and that is why we are going to choose transistors of different length. Okay. So, we choose transistors of different length, length as defined in the mask, okay, and then on all these transistors we do ID versus VGS measurement at linear region operation, meaning by very small VDS value, and then we choose, when we do that, for example, I will have curves like this, IDS versus VGS, okay, for one transistor, and then IDS versus VGS for a different value, different length transistor, and so on and so forth. So, in all these cases, what I will do is that I will choose a particular value of VGS in all these transistors, and at that value of VGS, I find out what is my IDS, and I also know what is my VDS, and hence I am calculating R channel at, you know, for different transistors that I have, right, because I am choosing VGS minus VT. I know VT, I know I am choosing VGS, I am doing this for the same VGS minus VT value on all transistors. So, I know this, I know this anyway, right. Okay, and I do not know L effective, I am trying to get L effective, but I am computing R channel. Now, what I am going to do is the following. All I am going to do is that I am going to construct a plot of R channel as a function of L. Okay. And what is this L, by the way? L is L on mask. I know L on mask was 1 micron, 2 micron, 4 micron, right. So, I have 1 micron here, let us say, and for 1 micron I got some R channel value, and for 2 micron transistor I got some value, and so on and so forth, right. For multiple transistor measurement I have got all these values, right. And then what I know, I have got different values of this R channel, right. And then I am going to sort of connect all these and make an extrapolation. Okay. So this extrapolation is coming by actually measuring this resistance on different length transistors. So what is this telling you? All this is telling you is that at this value, okay, your R channel goes to 0. And what is our R channel equation? R channel equation is this. What is this, by the way? L effective. L effective is L minus 2 delta L. Correct. So if this is going to 0, then L should be equal to 2 delta L at that point. Correct. In other words, when L is equal to 2 delta L, L effective is 0 and hence R channel is 0. So in other words, by actually looking at the intercept of this straight line where R channel is 0, I know that this should corresponds to 2 delta L value. Okay. So in other words, what I have been able to do is to really get that extent of lateral diffusion in all these transistors, and all these transistors the lateral diffusion is the same. Now then, if I want to get L effective for 1 micron transistor, I am going to subtract 1 minus this 2 delta L value, that is my L effective, and L effective for this is again 2 minus this value, and so on and so forth. Okay. So that is how you compute L effective value, by doing a electrical measurement, and from electrical measurement getting the channel resistance, and from channel resistance doing an extrapolation for 0 channel resistance, and hence getting 2 delta L value. This was quite okay, you know, in older generation technology, but in new generation technology there is a problem with this technique, and that problem is the following, right? And that is, I made an approximation, I told you that I do this IDS VDS measurement and I do VDS over IDS, and that gives me channel resistance. But in reality, it not only gives the channel resistance, but it gives this channel resistance in series with the parasitic resistance. Correct? Because the way you have, we have discussed this, there is a parasitic resistance here, there is a parasitic resistance here, and eventually your drain contact is coming here, this is where you are applying drain voltage, and your source contact is coming here, this is where you apply source voltage. When I do VDS divided by IDS, I am measuring this whole resistance. This whole resistance is R channel plus R SD or R parasitic, any other external resistance outside this transistor. In other words, this transistor in reality is an ideal transistor which is gate controlled in series with these parasitic resistance. Okay. So these parasitic resistances will affect your analysis, because you had earlier mentioned VDS over IDS is only channel resistance, but it is not so. VDS over IDS is R channel plus R parasitic, okay, and that is what you are measuring, correct? So then what will you do, right? How will you extrapolate this curve and get the L effective, right? So there is a very interesting technique. So that is, now L effective measurement in presence of, I will say, R parasitic. What I mean by R parasitic is that VDS over IDS is really what is called R total, which is R channel in series with R parasitic. When I am doing VDS over IDS, R total, essentially I am measuring both R channel and R parasitic. Now you see, there is something interesting one can do, and that is, R parasitic is fixed. Given a transistor, R parasitic is fixed, but R channel depends on gate voltage value. Okay. You see, what has happened is that there is a new variable that has come in. If I have to get rid of this new variable, I need another knob to play. So what I do is the following. Earlier I was constructing this graph for only one value of VG, but now I will construct this graph for multiple values of VG. The idea of doing this for multiple values of Eg is that by doing so, I am modulating R channel, but R parasitic is always the same. And hence, I should be able to get R parasitic and hence do delta L. Both will come out. So, the technique here is that do your R total measurement for different Vg values. If you do that, what you will get is something like this. Again, I am plotting for different length transistor. Again, I choose 4 or 5 different length transistor. Now, what I am plotting on the y axis is total measured resistance. I do it at one value of the gate voltage, you get a curve which looks like this. Let us say this is for you know, Vg equal to 4 volt. I do it for another value of gate voltage, that probably will look like this, and let us say this is Vg equal to 3 volt. Okay. And you know, you do it for another value of the gate voltage, you will essentially get a curve which would probably look something like this. Let us say this is Vg equal to 1 volt. Okay. Very interestingly, all these curves will intersect at some point here. What are you doing here really? Vg equal to 4 volt, your R parasitic is constant, R channel has certain value. When I decrease the Vg value, R channel increased, because Vg is decreasing and there aren't as many electrons and I am modulating R channel, but R parasitic stays as it is. Right, that is why the resistance increases here for a given channel length transistor. Right, remember I am doing all these measurements for different values of the channel lengths. Right, and there is one transistor with this channel length, another transistor with this channel length. Okay, and I have really constructed these transistors, and I am doing these measurements on multiple transistors, and from there I am extrapolating. But I am not going to look at this point, but I am going to look at this point, because this is the point of interest for me. What this is going to tell you is that the fact that all of them meet here, you know, that is what is your parasitic resistance, R parasitic resistance. Parasitic resistance constant here at this value, and in fact at this value your R channel is 0. That is why all of those are giving your constant resistance, you see. That is why all of them are really meeting at this point. If you look at this equation, when R channel is 0, R total is R parasitic, and R parasitic is same no matter what is the length of your transistor. It is not going to change, and hence all of them start from this point. Beyond this, you see, as you start you know, applying different gate voltages for the same parasitic value of the resistance, R channel here is much lower for this transistor at 4 volt compared to 3 volt, and hence I get a this curve at 4 volt, this curve at 3 volt, this curve at 1 volt. And that is why all of them meet at this value, and this is R parasitic and this is 2 delta L. Okay. Now, even though the transistor has lot of parasitic resistance, I can simultaneously get the value of parasitic resistance as well as the lateral diffusion that has happened. And once you get 2 delta L for all these transistor, I go back and subtract this 2 delta L and get L effective. Right. So, this is a very interesting way of getting a electrical channel length, and this is important because once you make transistors in large number of chips, you know, it is very difficult for every transistor's length to be measured optically or using electron microscopy. But electrical measurements are very fast and non-destructive, right. So, by doing this electrical measurement, you can actually do a lot of analysis on these transistors. Okay. Okay. So, one last topic that we will look at today is to measure the DIT or interface traps. Okay, from transistors. Okay. That is using IV measurement, you know, some kind of a current voltage characteristics measurement. And in fact, you know, I must tell you, the way this was discovered was really a serendipity. I mean, in fact, you know, people who were doing measurement on transistors for some digital application. Digital application, what you do, you essentially apply a pulse or a square wave kind of a voltage, you know, zeros and ones is what is applied to the gate voltage, right. And you would typically expect that, you know, you apply some source voltage, you apply from drain voltage, you have some current going from source to drain. But during such measurement, when you were applying AC waveform on the gate, there was some kind of a current that was measured at the substrate terminal. Okay. And you know, this was at the beginning, you know, very unusual. It is important that, you know, if you are doing some experiments, if you get unusual resistance, sometimes it may be beneficial to really sort of do more analysis on that unusual result. Okay. That may have some very interesting observation hidden there. Okay. And eventually it was discovered that the current that comes at the substrate, which was unexpected, is really due to the interface traps. And more specifically, if the interface trap density was very high, the current was very high, and if the interface trap density was very low, the current was also very low. In other words, the current was directly proportional to interface trap density, right. So, this turned out to be a very surprising and a very useful technique. Okay. Now, let us look at you know, what is happening really. In terms of the experimental setup, it is a very simple experimental setup. So, what you do is the following. I have a transistor okay. You can ground the drain terminal, you ground the source terminal, okay, and you essentially apply an AC waveform, square waveform, to the gate voltage, and you connect a DC ammeter to the substrate terminal, and you measure this current, which is also referred to as ICP, and ICP stands for what is called charge pumping current. Okay. So, what happens here? There is a certain condition here. Vg is being ramped, you see, Vg as a function of time, this is done over time, right. This Vg essentially is going between V high and V low. There is an important condition to do this charge pumping measurement, and that is V high should be greater than Vt and V low should be less than VFB, where VFB is the flat band voltage of the transistor and VT is the threshold voltage of the transistor. Okay. This is an important condition. Let us say we satisfy this condition, then what happens? Let us do this analysis. If my gate voltage is at VH level, because VH is greater than VT, the entire transistor will be inverted, correct. So, it will have large number of electrons. Okay. So, let us do that analysis here. For Vg is equal to Vh, which is greater than Vt, what you have here is large number of electrons, these are all electrons. We will also look at the band picture in a minute. Okay, why do not we just do that here. So, if you were to do the band diagram here, what will happen for the band diagram? If this is your oxide, you applied a positive voltage to the oxide, and okay, this is how the band diagram will look. Lot of electrons will be there. Fermi level will be very close to conduction band. Most of the interface traps are filled with electrons. Now, let us look at the condition. Vg is equal to VL is less than VFB. Remember, VFB is a flat band voltage. If you are below flat band voltage, then you are in accumulation condition, correct. So then what happens if you look at the transistor? This is your N plus region, N plus region, this is your P region, okay, N plus P region. Here you will have lot of holes coming in, okay. Now if you were to look at this band diagram will probably look something like this. Accumulation condition. Okay, but how did I go from high to low? I went from high to low with a pulse which has, let us say for the discussion for the time being, 0 fault time. Fault time is 0. From high to low I have come down instantaneously. When I came down instantaneously from high to low, what would happen? Just think about it. Of course, holes will come and accumulate because P is a majority carrier, lot of holes are available, they will come and just accumulate at the interface. But what happens to interface traps? Remember when we were discussing about the interface traps, I have been saying that interface traps have certain time constant, meaning the traps which are holding the charge, they cannot leave the charge instantaneously. The time constant may be from for fast interface traps, it could be from microsecond to millisecond, okay. I am saying that I am doing this transition at instantaneously, fault time is 0. In other words, when I created this, these interface traps eventually would like to empty out because the Fermi level position is below the interface trap levels, but it does not happen instantaneously. What happens instantaneously is large accumulation of holes. Now what happens, these traps which are still filled with electron at time t equal to 0, that fault time, they start coming out, electrons start coming out slowly from the interface traps because the steady state condition is that all the interface traps should become empty. So when these electrons are coming out here, they see these whole sea of holes, you know. In other words, we say there is an electron hole recombination. These electrons which come in here, they get combined with the hole and that hole gets replenished instantaneously because it is a huge majority carrier P type that I have. So all the electrons that come out will effectively constitute a current at the substrate terminal, because for each electron that is coming out, you need to provide a hole to recombine, and that hole is essentially provided from the substrate terminal. Right. So if you have large number of interface traps, there are large number of electrons trapped in, and hence they result in large number of electron hole recombination and hence large number of current, charge pumping current, okay. So this charge pumping current happens at this instance as well as at the next instance, you know, whenever I go from low to high and high to low, right. In all these instances, the charge pumping current is like a spike. Right. And what I do is an integration of this, you know, I average it out. That is why I have a DC ammeter here, right. I measure the total current. If your frequency is f, you know, that sort of averages out over that frequency that you have. In other words, your charge pumping current, it turns out, is given by Q times NIT, okay. Times, of course, the area of your transistor times frequency. This frequency is essentially your AC frequency that I have. If you have larger frequency, you have more current, because in 1 second you have more such transitions, and a lot more times you have filled and emptied electrons and holes in the traps, okay. All that averaged out and you have more current, okay. So now NIT is total traps, because what I am doing from inversion to accumulation is I am spanning the entire trap density from flat band to 2 phi B condition in the band gap, right. This entire traps in this region are either filled or emptied, and they are responding to this fast varying RAM. So, as a result of that, if you were to compute ICP, you know what is your frequency of operation and you know what is your area, and you know you would be able to compute NIT, and from NIT you should be able to compute DIT. And in fact, if you actually do this measurement at different frequencies, you will see that your ICP versus frequency will be linear, and this is again a signature of the fact that this current is coming due to filling and emptying of the traps when I am going above threshold voltage and below flat band voltage, right. If you do not do this above threshold and below flat band, you would not be able to get this kind of a current. So, this is a very sensitive current, sensitive technique, you know, it is sometimes even more sensitive than the capacitance measurement techniques, okay. Capacitance measurement techniques have some limitations, whereas the charge pumping technique is a very sensitive technique. And you know, there is a lot of literature available in terms of measurement using charge pumping, and there are variants of charge pumping current which can even give a distribution of interface traps inside the band gap, because now what I am getting is a integrated value of interface traps between flat band to inversion condition, right. What I mean by that is, you see, if it is silicon with certain band gap, right, and this is mid gap, right. Oh. Flat band condition is Fermi level is here below phi b, I mean phi b below mid gap. When I reach inversion, Fermi level will be phi b above mid gap. So, this is the region that I am spanning. All the interface traps in this region are contributing to this current here. That is the integral of DIT over this region, right. So, what I told you just now is that there are variations of charge pumping current which can even give you distribution of traps in energy in this region, okay. But that is a finer detail of charge pumping measurement, so we will not really discuss about that. But suffice it to say that, you know, by doing this very simple technique which is very accurate, you should be able to measure interface trap density in transistor very accurately, okay. So, then let me just wrap up and summarize various parameter extractions that we looked at. Threshold voltage, as you know, is a very important parameter. We can extract the value of threshold voltage using the so called peak GM extrapolation technique, or using constant current VT definition, or using sort of sub threshold and linear transition, you know, as we discussed earlier. Then mobility can be extracted by looking at transconductance. Transconductance is essentially change in drain current for a given change in gate voltage, and hence you extract mobility. L effective is a very important parameter, which is an electrical equivalent channel length of a transistor, and in order to extract that, you choose transistors of constant W but varying length, and do some simple IV measurement and be able to extract L effective. And finally, charge pumping is a very powerful technique to extract interface trap density. So, let us stop at that.